minute.
All right, here we go, folks. Heat number one, event number six, the final event.
10 seconds. Athletes, stand by.
Gentlemen, here they go on the assault bike. Didn't get a chance to introduce them before. We're going to do it real quick as they're powering through their 30-calorie assault bike ride. Lane number one, Rodrigo Valenzuela. Quinn Boyer in lane two. James Sidwell in lane three. Lane four, Chance Ramos. Taylor DiMaggio in lane five. Lane six, Pablo Calhoun. Lane number seven, William Trujillo. Derek Peoples in lane eight. And lane number nine, Kawika Henderson.
All right, there's the roster. 30 calorie bike followed by 20 burpee box jump overs at 30 inches and 10 sandbag cleans. This is gonna go fast. We put a 6 minute cap on the workout. Looks like Sidwell, our first athlete now, onto the box jump overs. Peoples joining him, Calhoun as well. So you're one, two, and three. Sidwell, Peoples, and Calhoun. DiMaggio also joining in as well. Henderson too.
You said it, brother. It's going to go quick, fast, and in a hurry. 1 minute in, 6 minute time cap on this event. And again, 20 burpee box jump overs. You'll see them advancing those boxes, heading towards that 20 rep marker. And there's going to be 10 sandbag cleans. And those sandbags, 150 pounds for the fellas.
And every four reps, you see these athletes advancing that rogue box forward. Right now, Sidwell holding down that top spot. DiMaggio not far behind. And now it looks like Henderson in third place. So you're one, two, and three. Sidwell, DiMaggio, Henderson.
Henderson making up some ground. All these burpee box jump overs.
Athletes, we are 2 minutes in, 4 minutes remaining here. Come on, ladies and gentlemen, we're a little too quiet. This is the last event for these gentlemen here in 2017. Sidwell, still holding down that top spot. Taylor in lane number five, trying to hawk him down.
DiMaggio trying to stay steady on these box jumps, but it looks like it's going to be Sidwell turning and burning towards that sandbag. And he will be the first athlete to score a sandbag clean. DiMaggio next up though. And Trujillo will be the third athlete to the sandbag. So it's still Sidwell one, DiMaggio two, Trujillo three.
DiMaggio working very well right now on that sandbag, closing in on Sidwell. Four reps in for Sidwell as he advances the bag forward.
Same for DiMaggio, folks. You can see they are advancing those bags every two reps, heading towards that number 10 marker on the other end of the floor. 3:20 on the clock. Sidwell and DiMaggio duking it out for first place in this heat. And it looks like DiMaggio, two cleans in, and he will advance into the lead.
So now it's Taylor DiMaggio as Sidwell got a no rep, stumbled back a little bit. So now it's opening the door for Taylor. So Taylor right now, the strong leader, as he is looking to finish this thing out here, folks.
And DiMaggio completing another two reps, and he will advance it to the 10 rep marker, coming up on the 4 minute mark. One rep. strap in.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's get ready to bring Taylor home. And you can see the look on his face. He is leaving it all out here, ladies and gentlemen. Once again, the athlete must advance the sandbag. And there it is, folks. Taylor DiMaggio able to take heat number one here, the final event of the weekend. Gentlemen, we got 90 seconds remaining.
Hopefully we get an official time on DiMaggio, man. What a great job by Taylor. Looks like another athlete heading towards that finish line. Our earlier leader, Sidwell, will come in lane number three, right around 4:45. And now to lane number eight, Peoples. Bringing it to the finish line, round out your top three as we approach 5 minutes.
Boyer also bringing it home. And now Ramos bringing it home at the 5 minute mark. That means less than 1 minute remaining. Official time for DiMaggio, 4:21.
Trujillo bringing it into lane number seven, right around the 5:17 mark. 5:18, the official time for Trujillo. Kawika Henderson walking it in with 30 seconds to go. And Henderson will finish up at 5:33. 20 seconds, fellas. Calhoun looking to finish up in lane number six, 10 seconds to go. Short 6 minute time cap on this event. And we're gonna count it down, folks. 3, 2, 1. That's time. Big round of applause for all the fellas in that heat. Taylor DiMaggio sitting the time to beat, 4:21. Going into heat number two. Alright, ladies and gentlemen, here comes heat number two. The final event for your individual men, event number six, presented by Compex. You saw how it breaks down quick, fast, and in a hurry. 6 minute time cap, 30 calorie bike, 20 burpee box jump overs, and 10 sandbag cleans. And they'll work their way down the field, finishing by carrying that sandbag to the finish mat. Our fellas all out getting their bikes adjusted. Let's introduce these gentlemen in heat number two, lane number one, Dave Suave. Lane number two, Maximiliano Aragassi. Lane number three, Jordi Gribillon. Lane number four, Maximilian Vargas. Lane number five, Austin Richhill. 1 minute.
Lane number 6, Connor McDonald. Lane 7, Nicholas Heck. Austin Garavagali in lane number 8. And in lane number 9, Matt Morton. Seconds. Vargas not messing around. We'll have to wait and see. He may have gotten there at the same time. I'm just behind him, 3/100ths of a second off.
We're a little over 4 minutes in. Aravaglia trying to bring it in, but it's going to be McDonald who gets across that line first. Lane number one, Suava closing it out as well.
Stellar times all the way through. Aragassi bringing it across the line. Rich Helm almost there. Grimion at the last two reps. Rich Helm in white, Grimion in red. Jordy, one more rep to go. Rich Helm gets it up and over. And it's going to be a race to the finish, and Grimion might have stolen. He did steal that one at the end.
There we go, rolling it in, whatever it takes to get across that finish line. Big round of applause to these athletes. They have completed their South Regional Experience. Shout out to Morton for getting it done in 3:44. Congrats, guys.
The Alamo Dome, and we're finally here. Event number six on day number three, the CrossFit Games South Regional. I'm Jeff Weiber alongside James Hobart. The last 100 points. We have talked about jockeying for first place, trying to get that number five spot and get to the games. And before we move on, I want to give a little bit of credit to Dakota Rager. He's kind of pulling the Tia Claire to me this week. He's just always there, and he's going to find himself most likely in a spot to Madison, Wisconsin.
Dakota's been really consistent all weekend. He has two first-place finishes, but on this last heat as we approach it, my eyes are on Tommy Venus. Rookie debut, he's in that fifth-place spot by about 20 points. I think he's going to be the guy to hold it down as we close out Sunday.
Let's take a look at the standings so far with just 100 points remaining here in the region. Logan Collins, 460 points, running away with this one, but there's Dakota Rager. And again, you can see the point standings, Venus, Sweeney, and Miranda, three vying for that final spot to Madison.
It's going to be one heck of a fight here as we move into this last event. We don't have much data on what this is going to look like, but I don't think Sweeney is going to be able to edge this out.
Taking a look at how they line up. But again, this is heat number three. Josh Towers had a nice day already. He'll be over in lane five. You see him coming right in the middle there. Grant Melrose in lane six. So this is an event where you just go fast.
For those of you back home, they're looking at 30 calories here on the Assault Air Bike. Now, some of these guys have been finishing that in under 35 seconds. That is just about a calorie a second. So go into your gym, give that a shot, and see what you feel like afterwards. These guys have to move from that to 20 burpee box jump overs and then finish with 10 sandbag over the shoulder with a 150-pound bag.
And they're underway. And here we go with the assault bike. It's going to be a 30-cal sprint. They love when a box gets the bike for the first time, and athletes kind of look at it and go, hey, what's that thing? Is it tough? And I tell them, hey, let's do three 10-cal sprints. You can have as much rest as you want in between.
They call it the devil's tricycle for a reason. It puts a hurting on you, especially the harder you try to hurt it.
Greatest quote I ever heard, if the doctor tells you you have 1 minute to live, get on the assault bike, it'll take an eternity.
That's a nice quote.
On the way already onto the burpee box jump overs. And if you watch the demo video that was on the game site, you can use those hands to help vaults over.
This is a little bit different than we've seen in the past at all levels of competition. Usually it's the hands cannot touch the top of the box. But when I spoke to Dave Castro about this event, he said I wanted to give them a chance to go even faster and burn it down as much as possible. So you have the hands as an option here. Hands and feet have to touch the top before you get a good rep to clear that thing.
That was Andrew Cefali that you just saw shirtless moving the box forward to the bottom of your screen. A couple of lanes over. It looks like Grant Melrose and Josh Latour. That is. Latour is going to be in the white shirt. I believe it's Melrose and the red shirt in the middle of your screen. And this is going to be fast and furious, folks. We will try to keep up as best we can. There is Melrose in the red shirt and Latour in the white shirt. Setting a really nice pace here to start things off. If you want to know how fast it was, Matt Frazier did it in 255.69.
That essentially means that Matt was off the bike in 30 seconds. That means he was done with his burpee box jump overs by just shy of 2 minutes and spent the rest of the time on that 150-pound sandbag. I don't know if these guys are going to come close to that.
Matt Morton did it in 344.11 earlier in the first two heats. So Glenn Latour in the white, and way up in lane number one, Guilherme Dominguez in the black top of the red shorts out of Rio Grande do Sul, Brazil. Iron Soldier CrossFit is making a move and a push, and he's the first onto the cleans.
So this is not just about 10 cleans in a row. After every second clean, you have to move the bag forward. And that is what I think is one of the real struggles of this workout. You got to pick it back up and step that thing forward. What a nightmare.
And one thing in week one, the athletes did not know until they did the athlete briefing. Not only do you have to do the 10 cleans, you got to carry it to the red finish mat. That's a nice little added bonus.
We saw Josh Latour get a no rep there a second ago. As you clean that sandbag, you got to make sure the knees and hips are locked out as it passes over your shoulder. You can lean back and arch back. We got to see those knees and hips locked out, though.
One safety measure, and these athletes know it. If you've got a sandbag or a stone at home, if you're going to throw it over your shoulder, please step forward with the leg first so you do not drop it on the back of the leg. Melrose and Dominguez. Melrose on the right, Dominguez on the left in the black shirt are one and two.
Melrose doing a really nice job making quick work of that sandbag as he moves it up.
Just about a one or a two rep lead for Dominguez on the left side.
Notice how aggressively these guys have to drive their hips into the bag as they try and whip it over their shoulder.
Melrose moving ahead of Dominguez. Melrose in the red top. Here comes Cefali. Not going to catch him. But Dominguez and Melrose back and forth. Again, you've got to get on the mat with the sandbag. There he goes on the way. He's not going to get the event lead, but he's going to win the heat as Grant Bellrose is in about 3:55. And there goes Guilherme Dominguez in as well.
You can see these guys celebrating. That's one of the best feelings you can have no matter what heat you're in. A heat win is fantastic. It's a great way to end out the weekend.
David Barrett made it in lane number two. He is crushed up top. You can see him laying on the floor. Lane number three, it's going to be Chris Reed who drops the bag onto the finish mat. It's just about anywhere from 3:44 to 4.5 minutes of suffer. And here is Josh Letower. The gorilla walks it across in a little over 4.5 minutes. 6 minute time cap. So just over a minute remaining. Andrew Cifelli at a Zero Machine CrossFit in Phoenix.
Under normal conditions, I don't think it would be, the sandbag wouldn't be that heavy for these guys, but take their heart rate near 180, and it's a whole different story.
Gives it the bear hug. I'm going to tell you, just anything, if you started off of any sort of bike sprint, these are pretty basic movements. Get over a box, pick something up, throw it over your shoulder. It's nothing super highly technical, but you race that heart rate up at a 30-cal sprint, anything we did was going to stink.
We've said this in CrossFit for years. Beware of the simple workout. It doesn't get more simple than this.
And in lane number seven, Arturo Bacciano out of Santa Catarina, Brazil. Worst thing you can do, walk into the box, look at the whiteboard, and go, that doesn't look too bad today. Yeah, it's going to be the worst you do.
Simple always means you can go faster, and that's what this final workout is all about.
That's Scott Tutlow and the purple. And in the black, in lane number four, Gilson Duarte. 10 seconds to go before the time cap. He's got a walk in there. Can you hang on? Up to another segment of two, and just will not be able to pick it up. That's just how bad it hurts.
That was a heck of an effort by Scott. Yeah.
Big round of applause for all of these athletes.
Well, that's a preview of what it looks like for two more heats, including the championship heat.
Bellrose didn't start out as hot as we saw Letower start out. Where he caught him eventually smooth on those box jump overs, where he really caught Letower was on those sandbag cleans. He was really able to grip and rip that thing off the ground in one smooth motion. He didn't have to pause at the hip. And then he was aggressive as every rep picking it back up. Solid, solid performance there. Beautiful way to end out the weekend for him.
So that's what it looks like, and we still have two more to go. Gives a big thumbs up. I don't know how he did that. Everyone else was just crushed, but we still have two heats remaining. For all the official information, remember to go to games.crossfit.com. Heat four coming up next from the South Regional. Two heats remain for this event number six. We've got heat number four later on, heat number five, 100 final points here at the Alamo Dome in San Antonio, Texas. I'm Jeff Prywood alongside James Hobart, and we just saw what this event can do, James. It is fun to watch, probably not so fun to do.
Very fun to watch, not so fun to do. After those 30 calories on that bike, you got to get over to that box and 20 burpee box jump overs. You're going to see the athletes advance that box every four reps. And then finally, 10 sandbag cleans at 150 pounds. They got to grip and rip that thing right off the ground over the shoulder.
It is all go here. Put your head down and suffer. And these Heat 4 athletes, their last chance for a big finish. They've got a chance for something, especially the ones in this Heat ranked 11th through maybe 14 or 15. A chance for these guys maybe to finish in the top 10.
Absolutely. And my eyes are on Marcelo Bruno as well as Marco Coppola, two of the bigger guys here in the event. Maybe this gives them a chance to showcase their strength if those burpee box jump overs don't crush them.
You know, you talk so much, and we talk so much between Enerton and Coppola and some other athletes about their strength and being able to pick up the sandbag. That also provides a ton of force on this bike.
Absolutely. Being a little bit bigger, a little bit taller, allow them to push hard on that bike, drive those watts up so they can accumulate calories faster. But you got to remember, those burpee box jump overs aren't as easy when you're a 200-plus pound guy.
Big guys like to move move weight. They don't necessarily like to move themselves through space.
Yeah, well said.
Speaking as a larger athlete, I'd rather, I don't care what apparatus you give me, if I can pick it up and move it around, I'm a lot better than saying you move around.
Burpees, no thank you.
Here we go, 30 cal sprint. And this is not a relative sprint if we had a longer time domain. When we talk about sprint here, we are talking about all out sprint.
And we've seen the fastest time so far was Matt Fraser up in the East with 2 minutes 55 seconds. We've seen some fast times out of here, and these guys might be able to chase that down.
Not yet 30 seconds in. Here's the time to beat. Matt Morton did it in 344.11 earlier today.
We've already seen, we saw two athletes come right off in under 30 seconds and go right to work on those burpee box jump overs. There's Marco Coppola in the middle, red top, gray bottoms, moving pretty quick on those burpee box jump overs. I can't wait to see what he does when he gets that sandbag.
Got a pretty good pace right now. He's going to have to be off in a minute 52 if he's going to stay ahead of Matt Frazier's event record at 255.69.
All of these guys, solid pace. You got to remember, every time they've dragged that box forward, they've added four reps to their total as they approach those 20 reps for the burpee box jump overs.
Or event records, they're nice to have. More importantly, can you try to get 100 points and an event win for these guys getting the top 10? More importantly, later on, before Heat number 5, get a top 5 and make it to the games. But it's Coppola still out in front, and now he just lost it. He just lost it to Andrew and Primo.
Primo had some pretty exciting showings this week, and he's doing a really nice job of making things easier for himself. You notice he's quick to kick down into that burpee, jumps up with both feet. That can make things a little bit faster, a little more efficient. You see some other guys here do kind of a one-foot step up, which can save energy, but it's a whole lot slower.
Wow, Primo already on to the cleans. He's ahead of Frazier, who was at 150. Now he still has more. I thought he was going to turn around and go to the med ball. Pardon me, now he's behind Frazier's pace.
It's hard to count when your heart rate's 190 beats per minute.
He made that turn and began to walk to the med ball, but Coppola's going to regain the lead. He's got 10 of these. You'll have to advance every two. And oh, by the way, you guys have to carry this thing to the finish pad.
I want to see if he's going to go touch and go. If he can step forward, touch it. There he goes. And then right over the shoulder. That's the first athlete we've seen do that.
The regional and team games vet knows those little tricks. Primo just behind him in the black top. Here's Coppola. Coppola's strong enough. He can reach down and pick up a 150-pound sandbag without having to pull it up with the bear hug, rest it on the knees, and get that big hip kick. He's strong enough to muscle it over.
Most of these guys are taking it in kind of one movement from the ground. You'll see some athletes, when things get heavier, they start to slow down. They'll lap it, bring it to their lap, pause, and then try and whip it over their shoulder.
3:44, the time to beat here in the South, and Coppola continues to march up. Couple more reps for Coppola. Primo took a brief lead. Coppola took it right back. Marco Coppola, he's going to smash the time to beat as he is going to be in at about 3:08. Unofficial time for Marco Coppola, the new event leader in the South, is Andrew and Primo. Has two more reps.
That's a testament to his fitness and his focus. He had that huge screw up on the burpee box jump overs, and he's still hanging tough here to finish this workout.
Primo, his final one. He'll have to pick it up. And look out, there is the guy we've been kind of watching this weekend. Marcelo Bruno gets ahead of Andrew and Primo. We thought this would be a good event for Bruno, and it was. 6-minute time gap, so a little over 2 minutes remaining here in the heat. And the next athlete to finish is going to be Lance Castle up top in lane number one out of Albuquerque, New Mexico.
Really solid weekend for Lance Castle as he's kind of pushed himself up in the heat.
Kendall Kersey is in at a CrossFit day one in Fort Worth, Texas. Less than 2 minutes remain. Jared Enderton should be the next. He has one more if Enderton doesn't let Matt Strand pass him. Enderton will get it up first.
This is one of those really hard movements where if you don't have motivation, somebody to chase, you sort of lost your goal. It's easy to let that heavy thing rest on the ground.
Enderton drops it with about 4:25 on official time. And in lane seven, Matt Strand is in right around 4.5 minutes. These athletes have plenty of time to finish. Lane number four, there goes Alan Garcia. Garcia, can he hang on? Yes, he does. 4:45. I believe that is Kirk Ritchie, our final athlete, to try to wrap things up out of Cityside CrossFit in Houston, Texas. Rookie to the regional. He's going to come in right at 5 minutes. So he has completed, as have the other athletes here in heat number four. Marco Coppola, 309, just a fraction of a second over 309 for Marco Coppola. Fast and furious for this event number six that all started off with the 30 cal assault bike. I don't know, James, if it would be worse to start with the 30 cals or finish with 30 cals in this one.
Neither. We'll take it right out. I was really impressed with Marco Coppola. We so often get into the argument, does the workout favor the big guy or the little guy? CrossFit regionals events favor fitness, and he did a great job biding himself some time to get up to that sandbag, and once he got there, it was just all touch and go for him. He was easily able to pick it up, whip it over the shoulder, step forward with it, and this was the big game changer for him. Touch to the ground, and then finish with those cleans. Really nice job by him throughout the entire weekend.
And he's standing by with Nick Zolinski.
Marco, an incredible finish for you. You set the new time to beat 1 year after making it to the games on a team. How would you classify your regionals experience as an individual this year?
Bittersweet, a little bit of disappointment in the fact of the way things turned out. And, you know, it was really fun last year, but this was probably my last year to do individual and try it and give it a shot. So go back to focusing on team. So there's a lot of aspects and fun things to look forward to. And I've been doing CrossFit for a pretty long time, so I'm not disappointed in my performances. I did about the best I could with the workouts that were given, so can't be mad.
Well, you end on a high note. Time to beat. You're looking at a top 10 finish likely for the weekend. Marco, go enjoy yourself. Congratulations.
I will. Thank you, guys.
Good job by Marco Coppola to finish strong. Has the event lead at 3:09. We'll have Heat 5 a little bit later. And again, we'll have the women coming up momentarily. For all the official results, head to games.crossfit.com. We are not done in San Antonio by any means, but we are finished with this heat. In the meantime, we'll head out to HQ. Sean and the crew with the update show.
Welcome back to CrossFit Headquarters. Sam Farber here alongside Games veteran Annie Sakamoto. And we are getting very excited for the dramatic conclusion out in the South, San Antonio, getting ready for the women's finale. And things are coming down to the nitty-gritty right now, Annie, as we take a look at the bubble watch. These are the athletes that are on the cusp of making it out to Madison and into the games. It's going to be very tight. There's 33 points separating third place and seventh place. That means if any of these athletes are outside the top 10 in this competition, they're going to be in some trouble, and that includes some games veterans like Margo Alvarez, who's trying to go for a fourth straight year. She's in the best position right now. Alexis Johnson was a rookie last year. She is currently right on the cut line. And then there's Candace Wagner, who's got the most work to do, hoping for her third trip to the game. So, Annie, as we look at these women who have had so much success in the past, who, in your opinion, is the one who's most likely going to be on the outside looking in.
Well, I'm hoping that it's Candace Wagner that actually moves herself into that top five position. She did herself some good by getting from eighth to seventh after that last workout. But what we need from her now is a lot of things to go right, like an event win, and some other things to go wrong for some of the other ladies for her to move into that qualifying position and go back to the CrossFit Games this year.
Should be very, very exciting, as all the regionals are. We're looking ahead to next week already. Much, much more to come. We'll be in three different regions for you, Central, Pacific, and California. Start time locally for all of them is 9 a.m., which means we'll be working pretty much around the clock here at HQ, bringing you all the best of all the events throughout the regionals on week number two. Now, earlier on today, I got a chance to catch up with one of the athletes who'll be competing in that Central Regional, and that would be Dan Bailey. Dan, last year, just missed on going to the games for a sixth consecutive year. Before I spoke to him, broke down what exactly went wrong for him in 2016. One of the most dramatic moments from the 2016 CrossFit Regionals was watching Dan Bailey try and make it to a sixth consecutive CrossFit Games. He gave it a great effort, top 10 in every single event, eighth place finish on event number one, sixth in event number two. Event three was his weakest in terms of finish. Wall balls and push-ups, he finished 10th, dropping him back to 8th place. Event 4, a 7th place finish, climbed the ladder. His best event was event number 5, running, GHD sit-ups and deadlifts. He finished 2nd, put him in qualifying position. But on Sunday, back-to-back 9th place finishes, including on event number 7 with thrusters and rope climbs, left him at 7th place overall, missing the games for the first time since 2010. Now Dan Bailey's trying to get back to the CrossFit Games, and we're going to welcome him here now live via Skype to talk about his efforts in the upcoming regionals. Dan, thanks so much for the time.
Absolutely. Thank you guys for having me on again.
It's our pleasure. Now, Dan, we just went through last year at regionals, top 10 in every single event, and yet you weren't able to qualify. How much does that speak to the level of competition that now exists in the CrossFit community?
I think it speaks volumes. I mean, there's having conversations with other athletes, there's really no easy region anymore. There's only regions that are a little bit harder than others, I guess is the best way to describe it, because everybody's so good. There's so many people now in the sport, and everybody's training really hard to try to get to the CrossFit Games.
What have you changed in an effort to make your sixth CrossFit Games?
I've worked a lot on some of my weaker movements, which is squatting. I spent a lot of time doing different kinds of squats, anything from heavy load, light load, to large volume. So that's where I put a lot of my effort in that, and again, trying to increase my aerobic capacity over the past year.
Dan Bailey joining us via Skype as he prepares for next week's regionals in the Central region. And Dan, every athlete has a game plan going into regionals on how they think it's going to play out, but you have an added advantage of watching how some of those athletes' game plans play out on the competition floor by watching week one. What have you learned from this first weekend in competition that maybe will change your strategy?
There's not a lot actually that's going to change some of my strategy. That being said, I've been very impressed with a lot of the times that have come out of the East for all those top five athletes and some of the times that have come out of the South as well. So I think you just have to get out on there on the competition floor, understand what's in your control, what's not in your control, stick to your game plan, and then at some point take some risks to try to jump up a couple spots.
And the best way to jump up a couple spots is usually to have an event win. It seems like everyone who qualifies for the games is either top three all the way across the board or they have that event win. Is there a particular event in this upcoming weekend of regionals that you feel you have the best shot at?
I'm a big fan of anything that's 21:15:9. So my favorite event for the weekend would probably have to be event 2. It's going to be really fast. There's going to be a lot of really good guys in the Central region at that workout. If I can nab one, I think that's probably my best chance to. And I've put in a lot of work actually in the last year in the weight vest. So I'm actually kind of excited about that workout. I don't enjoy those type of workouts, but I've put a lot of work in to improve my times for using a weight vest and for workouts like that. So hopefully I can finish pretty high in that one as well.
And we just went through it, Dan. Last year, you were in qualifying position going into Sunday and fell a little bit short. Is there anything that you take from that experience that you're going to put into your strategy for 2017?
Yeah, it's something actually that there's nothing that really I didn't learn a whole lot from it, because all my life I understand that failure is part of the game. Like, you're not going to win every time, all the time. I've had to deal with it in other aspects in college and in high school, and, you know, since growing up, I guess, young, playing sports. So it's what you do after you fail. Like, what's the attitude you take after that to go to correct how you want to achieve whatever goal that you came short of. So I feel like I've done that this year. I feel like I'm healthier. I feel like I'm fitter. And we're going to find out come Friday on when I compete at Central Regional.
You mentioned college. You live in Ohio, work in Ohio. You're in that Big Ten footprint. I know there's a lot of motivation trying to get back to the games after falling short last year, but is there additional motivation with the games now moving to Madison, Wisconsin? Not a quick drive, but it is drivable from where you are in Ohio.
I actually have a lot of ties to Madison, Wisconsin. My dad is from Wisconsin, and he went to UW. So we actually have a lot of friends up there. So I guess that adds just a little bit of pressure. Like, it would be great to go compete up there among all them and have them all come out to kind of enjoy the games and enjoy watching me compete. So that's a little bit of added pressure, but it's not the number one thing on my mind.
All right, Dan. Well, thank you so much for the time, and best of luck next week in the Central Regional.
Appreciate it, guys. Thank you.
It's going to be very exciting watching Dan try and compete and get to compete in the CrossFit Games in front of a few more family and friends than maybe otherwise would have happened in California. Lots of excitement for you right now. We've got five men, five women ready to qualify for those games in Madison, Wisconsin, competing in the South Region. Final heat of event number six coming up right now in San Antonio.
Here we go, heat number one. Our women's event number six making their way to the competition floor.
fans getting their bikes adjusted again. This will be their last event for this weekend, day three, 2017. We've got CrossFit Games South Regional here at El Dorado in San Antonio, Texas. Going to introduce the heat to you in lane number one, Chris Schmidt. Meredith Smith in lane number two. Lane three, Mindy Hughes. Alyssa Lafont in lane number four. 1 minute. Anatoly Nicole in lane number five. Alyssa Christian in lane six. Lane seven, Chelsea Lewis. Lane number eight, Costanza Carrera. Andrea Rodriguez in lane nine. And in lane 10, Jamie West. Seconds. Several heats of competitors to go, including our final heat of competitors coming up here in a bit. Five for those five spots. Then to the CrossFit Games.
A hand up for Alyssa Lafont. Over in lane number four, hands up for West Rodriguez Cabrera. We are going to have some movement here. Alyssa Christian. First to move, but here comes everybody else. Those ladies working with 24 inches. They are doing 20 burpee box jump overs.
About 90 seconds in, it looks like West advancing our box just behind Smith.
Yep, so one Smith, two West. But it is a much too close of a race to call just yet. Coming up on 2 minutes, that time cap is 6 minutes. As these ladies crank through individual event six, presented by Compex.
Just past 2 minutes on the time clock. You get 6 minute time cap, but just pointed it out. These ladies keeping the race really close here as they're closer to the last of their burpee box jump overs.
Rodriguez, West, Cabrera, Lewis, all on the competition floor for the final time. If you're just joining us, this is Heat 1, Event 6 of the Women's Individual Competition. It is short and spicy indeed. Alyssa Lafont. First to that sandbag, followed closely though by Jamie West. Jamie West versus Lafont, and here comes Mindy Hughes and Rodriguez over in lane number nine. They are responsible for 10 sandbag cleans at 100 pounds.
Lafont advancing next, touch and goes. Lafont in the red shorts and purple top.
Making short work of those two grabs, Kiki, she will advance forward. And touch and go.
It's a good strategy, right? Why throw it down and then have to reach underneath it again? She uses that momentum to where she can pull it right back up. Here she goes. Let's see if she can do it again. Yep. Nicely done as we hit 4 minutes in. 2 minutes remain. Getting under that sandbag, rolling it up and over 100 pounds. It's not a problem for Alyssa LaFawn, your leader in lane number four, in those red shorts with two reps to go.
She sets that down, resets, and she is one rep in.
She better move because Rodriguez is coming for her.
Those bags hit the ground at the same time. Kiki Rodriguez.
Rodriguez with the slight edge. It's going to go Rodriguez, West, and then LaFawn.
That looked like Rodriguez and West right behind her.
Literally just taking a breather right there. Rodriguez is able to keep going right after she completed that clean. Pick it up and win, and we'll take this heat. 1 minute.
Hughes bringing it in at 451, Smith at 501.
50 seconds, athletes.
Cabrera finishing up at 507. Christian making her way across the line at 520.
Athletes, you have 30 seconds. Schmidt and Lewis trying to finish this sucker up.
Schmidt has it up and moving 20 seconds on the clock. And Schmidt will finish up planting the sandbag on the stop mat at 5:43.
Chelsea Lewis needs to carry it in with 10 seconds to go. She will cross that finish line. Lewis closing it out, counting down in 3, 2, 1, tie. Big round of applause for our Keith One athletes. They are done.
Stevens in lane 7, Renata Pimentel
In lane 6, Steve Panea. In lane 5, Anita Pravati. In lane 4, we've got Marina Ramos-Jorge. Lane 3, Teresa Trojanowski. Lane 2, Leslie Daggy. And lane number 1, Morgan Bullitt.
Remaining for Anita Pravati.
advancing. Pravati, though, able to move yet again. She has two reps remaining.
You said it, Kiki. Final two reps here. Pravati, one more rep remaining now. And there it is. All she's got to do is clear the finish line with that sandbag. And Anita Pravati going to have the new time to beat here. As she closes in at the 3:58 mark.
Renata Pimentel in lane number 7. She's got the green t-shirt on and she's on the move. Pimentel is done. Here comes Tina Pinea. Pinea closes it out.
So Pimentel with 4:12. Pinea, 4:20 official times. We close down to 90 seconds. Randy Stevens now going to be our next athlete to finish out. And Stevens with an official time of 4:38. And now Bolin and Daggy going back and forth here. Looks like Bolin's going to be our next athlete to finish down here in lane number 1. And now Daggy and Tranokowski.
1 minute to go. Virgin in lane number 10, Alexis.
Bojanowski able to get it done here in lane 3, as well as Bowen down there in lane number 10. And Daggy. So Trojanowski 5:13, Bergen 5:14, and Daggy 5:19.
30 seconds. All right, with 2 reps to go, about 20 seconds remaining, you guys.
Come on, San Antonio, let's make some noise. Jorge trying to bring it home here.
Three, two, one, time.
All right, big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen.
As these ladies have capped off their weekend here at event number 6.
Final two heats, event number 6 on the final day of the CrossFit South Regional in San Antonio, Texas, inside the Alamo Dome. I'm Jeff Bryman alongside Sheree Chan. This one is fast and furious, Sheree, and this is going to be great. These next two heats, heat four battling to maybe finish with the top 10. And once we get to that final heat, 40 points separate, five spots up for grabs.
40 points in this event is going to be a gut check, because really it's about, hey, after getting off that bike, can you just hang on all heart, battle it out? It's going to be fun to see those women who really want to get to the games and really pour it all out onto the floor.
Let's see it. It's all shaked out now coming into the final event of the day as we take a look at the overall standings. Again, two really good races. Camille and Tennille for the top spot. And again, 3 through 8 separated by 40 points.
A couple of really interesting things going on. Bethany Branham is the only rookie in this lineup. And can she, for her first time at regionals, make it with a game spot? That is just fascinating. Barista Mayfield is looking on the outside, looking in again. This is her fifth regional. It'd be really cool to see her break that line and get into the games for her first time.
This may be my favorite event that Dave Castro has ever cooked up for a final. Nothing too difficult or too technical, just go.
It's all guts and no glory at the end. A couple of things to make note of is the size of the box, 24 inches. There's also a little technique going on there because you can put your hands on it. The sandbag is 100 pounds for the lady, and there's a 6-minute time cap, but I don't believe any of these ladies will be butting up against that time cap.
Here's how they line up. Tyler Rashad, the top athlete here in this heat, and Brenda Castro, one last chance to finish out strong, maybe finish with a top 10 this weekend. Underway, 25 cows on this bike, and it's not a relative term. This is not a long time domain. When they say 25 cow sprint, they mean sprint.
We are looking for these ladies to get off of this bike in about a minute. They're going to be holding somewhere around 80 to 90 RPM for those of you that go ahead and do this bike at home, which is just unbelievable to make that happen. And there are two women in this heat that mathematically could still get that fifth spot, and that's going to be Tylin Rashin and Brenda Castro.
For those that have never done an assault bike, find it at maybe another local box in your town. Do a couple 10 cal sprints. Take as much time as you want in between. It's going to hurt. Heard a great quote one time in an article. The doctor... go to the doctor's office, they say, sure, you got 60 seconds to live. Get on the assault bike, it takes an eternity.
It'll feel like forever.
All right, lane number 3, here we go. And it's going to be Kelsey Kyle on a CrossFit Nerling. She has the early lead.
She got off of that bike quick. And now it's going to determine, hey, how quickly can we get to the ground and move through these burpees? And she is showing that that bike did not slow her down on this box.
Annalisa Marquez at lane number 9, unaffiliated, is the second to the burpee box jump overs. And again, of these athletes, and these athletes obviously did, if you watch the demo video they put out, and it was a great job by HQ, not only for the standards, but the full event, you can use your hands. I believe Dave Castro, one of these athletes, to push it even faster.
And it also adds another element of something they probably haven't practiced. So they have to adapt to a new method. And we can see there Kelsey Kyle right there slowing down just a little bit. The time we have to beat so far here in the South is 3 minutes and 58 seconds. We'll see how these ladies butt up against that.
Rashawn right behind her, but in lane number 9, again, it's Annalisa Marquez that's starting to move ahead. We just saw Anita Pravani do a 3:58.33 in the prior heat, and now there is the person that is pulled even. You can see Kyle way down the lane in the red top. So these two are going 1 and 2. Whoever pulls that box forward has 4 reps remaining.
There is a desire to stop here, and these ladies just need to keep pushing, moving, and just kind of really living in the pain on this one.
Watching both of the athletes out there, it's about a half a box jump, and now they are synced up. 2 more, and Marquez about a half box jump ahead in the black in lane number 9, second from the bottom. Here we go, 10 of these, and you got to move them up every 2 reps. And at the end, the bonus, you got to carry it to the finish mat.
And Elisa Marquez looking to better her finish from the last year's regional at 13th. She's currently sitting in 18th.
If you can touch it and go right back up, that is a little bit more efficient. But, you know, you're already blasted here. The heart rate already jacked up. Kyle takes a slight lead again. Oh, and no rep. And Marquez here gets a good rep. Marquez goes back in the lead by a rep.
This whole portion takes about 90 seconds for these women to get through.
And Marquez just was able to get up under it. Got him a big hip extension once it starts to really wear on you. That time, a nice job to vault it up over the shoulder. Look out in lane number 10. Here comes Chloe Wilson out of CrossFit Dixie. Number five, that was Rashawn, but here is Marquez, still your leader, but she's got company. Lane number five again, that is Rashawn in the blue top. Bernie Castro back there in the red sleeves lagging behind, but they are neck and neck between Rashawn and Marquez.
We now have four women in the second heat that would have already finished. So if they were hoping to get into the top 10, those ladies in heat number two said, we don't really want you to do that. We want to claw ahead.
And Kyle's across and in lane number nine. Looks like Marquez has finished as well. That gives you a good idea how fast Anita Pravati went at 358.33 earlier today. It was just a heat to go. And to give you another indication how quick Pravati was, only about 4 seconds off Catherine David's daughter, event record. Lane number 10 is Chloe Wilson out of CrossFit Dixie. Less than a minute to the 6 minute time cap. Coming on in is Cassis, unaffiliated, in lane number 7. And there goes. And finished in Latin America, moving across Brenda Castro to CrossFit Tigran. A lot of experience. Again, another year of big experience for Brenda.
It's her fourth regional. She got 10th in 2016.
Lane number 4 is Beth Spearman. In the red top, going to be a race with lane number 8, Raven Barrett. They're in there right about the same time. We have one athlete remaining on the floor in lane number 2, Luisa Diaz, who really had a really nice event number 5 today. And Diaz stumbles, trying to pick that 100-pound sandbag up. She's going to cap out with a couple of reps remaining. And that's a 6-minute time cap here in heat number 3. It's a destructive event. Short but effective.
Very effective. If the response is killing the athletes. How amazing right here. We saw such quick burpees off of Kiel throughout this whole thing. She was just nice and consistent. It really held her composure because she did get a couple no reps on this sandbag over for having her knees bent. So brilliant job, Kiel.
She gets in there and you can see the devastation this takes. Doesn't take long. That's the high intensity portion across. It doesn't take long to get the results that you need. Speaking of results, for the official results, not only here in this heat, but in this region as well as the East that wrapped up a little while ago and the regions to come, go to games.crossfit.com. Coming up next, the final heat. 10 athletes, 5 spots remain on the line for a trip to Madison, Wisconsin here at the CrossFit South Regional in the Alamo Dome. fun continues, and it's going to be exciting and explosive. It's the final heat of the weekend for the women. I'm Jeff Freiman alongside Sheree Chan, director of the CrossFit Games, Dave Castro. Dave, the simpler an event looks, even when you go to your box and look at the whiteboard, the more destructive it can be. This is going to be incredible.
For sure. We saw some good times out of the East region from this morning, and I think we've seen some good times here, and we're about to see some great times, and this is going to be an exciting show.
40 points separate the third spot from Alvarez and the eighth spot in Jessica Alvoy.
I'm looking really at Barista Mayfield there. She's just hanging on the outside looking in. She's done that now 5 years in a row. Let's see if she can kind of make it to the games.
Short and sweet, Sheree. 25 cows on the bike, followed by the box jump over, Burby box jump over, 10 sandbag planes. Nowhere to hide in this event.
A little higher of a box than usual, 24 inch, and they can use their hands, as well as that bag being 100 pounds.
Get two different races. Camille and Tennille racing for the top spot here in the South. But Brista Mayfield right now in lane number 8 is 10 points out of the qualifying spot.
10 points out. She doesn't want to be a few points out again. You can see the look of determination on her face.
About ready to start. Underway, we're going to start it out with 25 cows on the bike. And Dave, when you designed this, nothing relative about this. If this is a long time domain, a sprint is relative. Nothing relative. You got to go.
Yeah, you don't really have to. There's no strategy. You just move. Move as fast as you can. There is strategy in how fast you go on the assault bike. There's a little strategy in the technique you use over the box. But, I mean, it's really just pedal to the metal. And on the box, we when I originally programmed it, it was the intent was a burpee box jump and over. As we went through the standards and looked at the actual how we were going to require them to do it, we decided, you know what, let's allow the hands to touch and let's let them do that so we can speed it up and increase the intensity. And I think it accomplished that.
It also accomplished a couple people having no coordination as they get on it because they're not used to using their hands on that box.
Looks like Candace Wagner is off.
That first one out there is Bethany Branham. She's actually our rookie out there in the field, never having been to a regional and hanging so tight right there to a game spot in fourth place.
So Bethany Branham right now is in, and she is doing what she needs to do. Again, Anita Pravati has the time to beat at 358.33. She did it two heats ago. Pravati there in the light blue shorts.
Surprised to see Camille and Margo so far back in this heat.
That's what's on the line. There's the bubble. Alexis Johnson in fifth place holds that last spot by only 10 points. Branham's not safe, but she's doing what she needs to do here. Mayfield and Wagner within striking distance.
Really, that we are looking at Barista, and we're also looking at Alexis Johnson, because Alexis Johnson is the one that this is hers to lose. So she needs to move quickly so that she doesn't lose that fifth place spot.
Johnson right now in the top four. For the top two in lane number 7 is Branham. In lane number 3 is Johnson. Those two doing what they need.
You can see the technique on pulling the box. If they lift it a little bit, they're going to decrease the drag as they pull it over. But some of them are almost pushing down, and that's making it a little more difficult.
And the bottom of those boxes, they have a unique grippy surface on it, so it's definitely not the way to do it.
Is that intentional?
Yes.
Bethany Branham still hanging on to the top spot here, and a spot to Madison, Wisconsin. It's still in second place. It's Alexis Johnson with the final spot.
It's Velcro on both sides.
Yeah, Cammy and Margo, their technique seems to be paying off. They're catching up to a lot of the other women.
Tennille Reed, the first to the sandbag.
Bethany Branham is second. She's like, I want my spot.
So both of these athletes, Tennille battling Camille. They're tied at points. Camille has a tiebreaker right now, but Tennille Reed can take the whole thing here. Branham behind her, just trying to get a top five, and Branham pulls into the same space.
Ooh, it is tight for these ladies, especially between Barista Mayfield and Alexis Johnson fighting for that spot number 5.
Tennille Reed moves forward again.
Her heart is big as Texas, and she moves on.
Tennille Reed closer and closer, about four reps away from being the champion of the South.
Watch Margo. I think Margo is making a little move on her. Yeah, I think Margo might be taking
a couple of reps behind her over there in the gray. See her in lane number four, Margo Alvarez. Alvarez and Reed.
Margo is second right now. It looks like Cam is now making a move to pull herself up there.
It's a race. Margo, it's going to be Margo Alvarez. Just beats Reed in under 4 minutes.
Phenomenal. But here's the deal. There are women that have already finished in heats prior.
You're right. Anita Pravati with a 3:58.33. Reed and Alvarez right around that time. Camille a little bit behind, but it looks like Tennille Reed is going to win the South. It's unofficial right now. Branham drags it across. Nothing official, so we do not want to speak too soon. We want to wait for the official results.
No, the desktop mathematics tend to be wrong most of the time.
Back across again. Couple of athletes left in lanes one and two. That's Wagner up there and Armstrong.
That is the fate for Candace Wagner. However, she really needed to do well here and other women to do poorly. So she will not be making it. I think that's a good assessment.
So Margo's technique paid off for her. Rein it in a little on the air bike and then really go for it on the last two. And she's tall and strong, so that bag must have been nothing for her in her mind going into this.
Well, she probably hauls around stuff at the vineyard all the time, so this was light for her.
Yep.
A couple of seconds ago, Jessica Alvoit finished in. Looks like she will not qualify, but what a performance by Alvoit this weekend. Lane number two, that's going to be Candace Wagner, and it looks like she'll miss out this season on the games, but a nice fight by Candace Wagner, who made it back to the games a season ago.
It's going to be a nail-biter to see if Alexis Johnson or Barista Mayfield will have made it for that fifth spot, because it's really hard to tell now. The other four ladies do look pretty solid, but that fifth one,
Sheena Hammer wraps it up. Everyone in under the cap. Great battle at the end between Margo Alvarez and Tennille Reed, and Camille made it interesting as well. It was Alvarez and Reed. It looked like Alvarez just edged her out.
What happened here is completely different as we went along. There is Alexis Johnson there, who's really fighting for her fifth spot. And what happened was Margo took her over and took over the field here on these sandbags as she barely runs in and makes it to first, passing Tennille Reed.
So Alvarez wins it, and Alvarez headed to Madison, Wisconsin. Outstanding performance here, and again, Tennille Reed dethrones Camille unofficially. We'll wait for all the official stuff, but it looks like she'll be the South Region champion.
Yeah, they were point for point going into this, so I don't think you're wrong with that assessment there, Jeff.
Boy, big smile on Tennille Reed's face, and for good reason, so is Margo Alvarez.
This was Tennille's fourth time to regionals. Was Cammie's eighth time to regionals.
Cammie, yet another trip, consecutive trip. I believe it's going to be her eighth consecutive to the games. So she'll make her way to Madison, Wisconsin this season.
It's a very small field of people who can claim that many consecutive trips.
So we've got 10 spots already filled here in San Antonio. Five teams are on their way. We'll find out shortly the five females who are on their way. And then here in a little while, we'll find out the five males that are headed to Madison, Wisconsin. As they kind of sit around, wait and see once the official results are announced. We have our top five to check out. Dave, I know a lot of people excited about the new location this year. Carson was special, but we're excited to move it around. It's gotten so big now. I know you wanted to take it out to the community.
I'm really excited about Madison. I've been there five times now, and I really love the city and the state of Wisconsin. The last time I was there, I traveled, put up 300 miles on my rental car. I went to a bunch of boxes. I think I went to 11 while I was there, and really got an appreciation for how beautiful it is there. And it just makes me really amped up and excited to take it there. It's going to be a great, it's going to be a great competition in a great state, a great city, at a great venue.
Let's take a look at the results now here in event number six. These aren't the overall standings. These are the event results. So Alvarez, Reed, of course, Camille had it. Brandon does a nice job, seventh overall.
When I look at this, I look at Alexis Johnson being an eighth, and what I'm doing is I'm looking down there for Brissa, and I don't see her again. So many crazy things can happen at this point, because we go past a certain point, we start to go down by 2 points, but it's looking good for Alexis right here.
Alexis Johnson had the 10-point lead. The judges and the scoring staff are together now.
There, 204 on the arm. That's Alexis Johnson just waiting patiently to find out if she's the one.
Milmo, she's headed to Madison, Wisconsin with a big smile.
Something would have to be terribly wrong for her not to have not made it.
Margot Alvarez securing her spot.
Tenille Reed, what an amazing showing by Tenille this weekend, 211.
I've kind of checked it out on the computer, Dave, going back to Madison, checked out the maps around that arena up there, the arena we're going to go to at Madison. A lot of water, a lot of great geography around there. I know you're not going to give anything away, but there's a lot of stuff to play with up there in Madison and that surrounding area.
There is a lot of water. There is a lot of water. There's no sharks, though. There's no sharks in this water.
Jellyfish?
Maybe we can bring some in.
You're going to have to give some obstacles for them to be frightful of. Come on.
I know.
Hurricanes? Tornadoes, maybe? They can do their workouts at 3 o'clock in the morning.
We'll have some good surprises this year. We always do. I'm excited. I'm amped up. This is going to be some great programming. It's going to be a great event. It's got me amped up. The change of location at first was really intimidating, and I was nervous about it, but now I'm really fired up and ready to go and ready to put on a tremendous show there.
Before that, though, you've got two more great weeks of regionals coming up. I know three next week, and in 2 weeks we have those two last regionals.
Yes, for sure. But mentally, I'm at the games. I'm already up preparing, programming, working on the schedule, working on how it's going to... Yeah, remember, we're doing a big format change. I don't know if everyone understands that, but in the past, we've done the Masters and Age Group competition on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and then Friday, Saturday, Sunday, we do the individuals and teams. This year, to have this massive festival and this massive competition, we're doing everything on Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
Wow.
So you're going to have... throughout a single day, three or four different things you can go see at any given time. Individuals, age groups, even the age groups this year were breaking up. So in the past, you know, we'd program for the Masters and then we just scaled everything. And, you know, as a spectator, you'd sit through and watch all these divisions go through the same workouts, same test. Now we're breaking them up into different groups. The teenagers will be their own age group. The three divisions of the 35 to 39, 40 to 44, and 45 to 49, they'll be their own group, moving group. And then the next age group division will be their own group. So those three groups will rotate to different areas. And then obviously there's a team and individuals, and they'll rotate through different areas and different parts of the park, call it, and different competitions. So it's going to be overwhelming. And in creating that, that is an overwhelming, it's not overwhelming, but it's a challenging task in creating that. So I've been working schedule, figuring out, like, okay, these two things are going to happen at the same time. These three things are happening at the same time. What I want to have happen at the same time and what I don't want to have happen at the same time. So that's my world right now. Now, this is all very important. I'm still here engaged and working and doing, seeing this stuff. But this was done, you know, a month ago, a month and a half, 2 months ago. All this first week for me is proof of concept. I needed to see these events go down and see these regionals run in the timeline we created, with the events we created, with the spacing we created. And the next 2 weeks of regionals will be a little, there'll be something off my shoulders. I'll be a little less stressed because, you know, again, we've proved the concept this weekend. You know, event two, not excited about what happened in the East, but stuff like that happens. So I think what we saw here, what happened at this region a few hours after all those injuries in the East, guys made an adjustment. Maybe they said, hey, I need to take it down from 100 miles per hour to maybe 98. There's a little self-preservation oftentimes that goes into these events that you need to take into consideration in knowing yourself. Maybe I just need to back off a little so I can make it through the weekend. And the fact that no one here, that we didn't have a repeat of what happened in the East, maybe that's a good sign that for the rest of the weekend, for the rest of the weeks, there'll be some good things to come, good things to see, and we won't have those injuries again. Fingers crossed.
Going back to all the moving parts you were mentioning, we'll talk about that a little bit later, but now let's go down to the floor with Kiki Dixon.
What a battle we had here in the South Regional! Without further ado, here's who's going to the games. In first, Tennille Reed! In second, Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet! In third, Margot Alvarez! In fourth, Bethany Branham! And the fifth athlete making their way to Madison, Wisconsin is Alexis Johnson!
There you go. Those are your final results. Dave, that's a very strong five you've got headed up to Madison, Wisconsin. Some familiar names, of course, and Reed and Camille and Margot and Alexis and Bethany Branham making your way up to Madison.
Great, great group of athletes. Can't wait to see what they do in Madison and how they represent this region and, more importantly, how they represent themselves. So I'm excited. Good group.
Competitive region as well. One heat to go for the men. We'll find out the five men that are going to make their way up to Madison, Wisconsin, as well as James Hobart will rejoin us here in just a second. But the men are coming up next. For all the official information, games.crossfit.com. The men are next here from the Alamo Dome. This is it, final heat of the entire weekend on week one of the CrossFit South Regional. Inside the Alamo Dome, San Antonio, Texas. You've seen the heats before. This is an wild, crazy, go-fast event straight down the lane. I'm Jeff Fiber alongside James Hobart. James, nothing to leave behind here with a six-minute time cap. You've got to go.
As usual, for our final event at Regionals weekend, we have a sprint, and this will leave nothing to be desired from a viewer standpoint. These athletes, however, might be left wanting a little bit more at the end of their season right here. There's some guys on the fence. Tommy Venus got to hold down that fifth spot if he wants to go to the games, but he has Sean Sweeney, former games vet, and Zachary Moran, newcomer, just kind of 20 points away, breathing down his neck.
Elijah Muhammad holding down that fourth spot with 373 points. Should be safe, but should, a relative term. You never know what happens in these final events, but mathematically he should be set there. So Logan Collins trying to finish off a very strong weekend. A guy you were going to watch from the beginning, but here's Easy Muhammad walking back to that assault bike. I'm going to be eager to see with those long, powerful legs how long it takes him on the bike.
I got a funny feeling this will be a good event for Easy. That is a heck of an outfit choice to close out the weekend, but maybe it'll bring him some good luck.
Maybe if he's more concentrated on how he looks, he thinks less about the paint. I don't think that's going to work out, but we will see.
As he heads to start off with that 30-cal bike, then he'll move on to 20 burpee box jump overs and then finish with 10 heavy sandbags over the shoulder at 150 pounds.
That's what we look at. Lanes 2, 3, and 8 are the most important for qualifying for the games. Again, 2, 3, and 8. Stand by. Here we go, 30 cals on the assault bike.
I expect all of these guys to be off under 45 seconds, if not less than 35 seconds. And you can see the hands, the feet are flying. They're driving those handles with everything they have.
And of course, head-to-head in this heat, very important. But you do have to remember the other heats have gone. Marco Coppola at 309.25. If this heat, or more importantly, those athletes on the bubble get mixed in with that, there's athletes they can't see could get in between them.
Those athletes like Sweeney as well as Moran, that time by Marco Coppola could matter a lot to them right now. Hopefully they took a look at it and know what they have to chase down.
Easy Muhammad, Joseph Gesder, and it's Tommy Venus who are your top three, and Venus wearing those green shorts and that cut off top.
No surprise seeing Gesner out front last year at the 2016 games when they had that 100% workout to close out Friday. 40 box jump over, 30 D-ball cleans. He finished the best out of all the finishers from the South Regional, so I expect him to do well here right now.
Venus is leaning Sean Sweeney. Sweeney the third for the bottom, and Venus in his black shorts on the right side, again with that cutoff shirt, doing what he needs. He's holding on to that final spot with 366 points against Sweeney and Moran at 346. Here is the bubble. Venus again, a 20-point advantage. Venus also ahead of Zachary Moran and the strike shorts now, second from the top. So Venus staying ahead of the two men who are chasing him.
Even Sweeney admitted he's not too explosive, and this is not his best event. However, I'll tell you right now, end of the weekend, with the chance he has to go back, he's giving this everything he has, weakness or strength.
There's Sean Sweeney, and there is Venus again. Venus on the right side, Sweeney on the left side. Venus, one segment ahead, so that's anywhere from 1 to 4 reps ahead. Zachary Moran, same thing with Sweeney as Moran pulls into the same segment with 4 reps. There is Moran with the American flag shorts, and Venus is off. Venus making his way. He is 10 reps away. 10 reps and then a sandbag carrier. Lane number one, Joseph Gesser trying to go out with a bang and trying to get not only this event.
Unless some sort of catastrophe here, it looks like Venus is punching his ticket up to Madison for his first games trip at 20 years old.
Easy Muhammad has pulled even. And now it's going to be Gesser remaining in first place, followed by Venus and Easy Muhammad. Easy Muhammad doing everything he needs to do to go to Madison, Wisconsin.
Easy going for that touch-and-go rep there.
Gesser maintains a 2-rep lead on Venus as he will bring it in to the next segment. Here's Easy. So Gesser, Venus, and Muhammad, your top three.
As nasty as that touch-and-go rep might be, it's probably the best choice here. Then you don't have to make that decision to leave the bag on the ground or pick it up again. It's already in your hands.
2 reps for Gesser to win the heat. Looks like that 309 may hold up. He's got 4 seconds to pick it up and get across. Looks like it'll be a little bit off of Coppola's time. It's going to be close. But a nice job by Gesser to finish out the weekend. Here's Venus. It looks like Venus did it. On to Madison.
He looks excited for that. We won't say 100% yet, but the way the math works, I think he's going up to the games.
EZ Muhammad in third in the heat. Boy, Venus is fired up. Lane number nine. Looked like Brandon Luckett is in. Travis Williams has finished, and there's Logan Collins, who has completed it. But it looks like Tommy Venus has held off the two men that were closest because they are still out on the floor.
Amazing weekend for Brandon Luckett as well. 22 years old, regional debut right here. Pretty amazing weekend for the young guys.
Rand lost the sandbag and collapses. He's still got to roll that onto the finish mat, and there it is. He is now complete. Venus at a zero machine CrossFit in Phoenix, Arizona. Boy, he is fired up. He knows he beat the two men close to him, Sweeney and Moran. Joseph Gesser, really nice finish there. Goes out with a bang. He won't qualify, but he gets a second place overall at 310.95. So he was just a fraction over a second off of Copeland's time. Lane number six, Dakota Rager. And boy, Rager put on a show. Quietly seemed to always be there. Oh, someone finished first and someone finished third. Oh, Rager was there as well. Again, talked about kind of a Tia Claire Toomey performance, just very consistent in the top five all weekend.
Two event wins as he heads closed out Sunday here. That might even be his worst finish. Really amazing job by him.
Again, nothing is official until we get the results from the judges and the scoring staff. But on the naked eye, unless something happened, they've got to go back and look at it. Tommy Venus should have secured that top five.
No surprise either that he was going to do well in that event with his strength numbers and how he's performed elsewhere in the weekend. Not surprised he was able to hold off Moran and Sweeney to get that trip to the games.
Joseph Gesser gets the heat win.
Like we said, you know, with his performance last year at the games with 100%, no surprise of his capacity to sprint, go fast, go hard. He was able to touch and go those cleans, which I think was kind of his key to victory, as we saw in earlier heats with Marco Coppola. He really pushed through that fast. Nice little second place event placing there to end out the weekend for Gessner.
Again, he'll finish in the top 10. We'll see how far he moves up the standings, but there is Venus again. Nothing is official until it is announced down on the competition floor, but he was pretty fired up about it.
He seemed really confident there. He came out hot off of that assault bike, pushed hard through the burpee box of overs, but like most of the races that have been decided in this event, he pulled ahead and finished strong on those sandbag cleans. And there we see him. Maybe we don't know it yet, but he seems pretty confident that he's going to Madison. I don't know why he'd be that excited.
Josh Bridges has some good celebrations. Tommy Venus is pretty good there. He has every right to be as well.
I thought he might redo the workout.
Tom, this is just the event results here. We don't have the final weekend results yet, but Coble hangs on to the event win by about a second and a half over Gesser, followed by Venus. Muhammad in fourth overall. Nice job by Marcelo Bruno out of Latin America. He won't qualify for the games, but he finally injury-free enough to get into the games and put on a nice show this weekend. Now if he can make it back next year, he knows how this goes.
Absolutely. And like, you know, a lot of young faces here in the South Regional making a name for themselves. If they continue to stay at it, I think there'll be threats for years to come. And that's always really nice to see.
Sean Sweeney, the look on his face, knows he made a great, great charge. But unfortunately, in this day and age of the CrossFit Regionals, not only consistency, but it's got to be high consistency. And a 44th place finish just knocked him down. He has a mid-pack finish of that, maybe going to the games. But hindsight 2020, went at it with maybe the right attitude. He put it on social media Friday night. He's like, look, I'm not going to dwell on it. I'm not going to blame anyone. I can only control the next four events.
And I don't think there was anyone else who could have made such an incredible push to try and squeeze his way back into that fifth spot. But that 44th is that piece that's going to hold him back there. And I think what's frustrating about this as an athlete is he looks at it and he's like, you know what, that doesn't reflect my fitness. That was an error of judgment in the moment. And that's a hard way to end your season. You know, everyone would rather have it be, hey, I died on the stake. It wasn't that, I overlooked something. That's always the worst part there. But amazing guy to keep his head up throughout that and fight harder than I think anyone else here could have for that fifth spot.
Well, you can see an easy Bahamut performance out of Sweeney next year. Easy missed it barely last year on that rope climb event after making the games the year before in his debut. I'd watch with Sean Sweeney next year in the 2018 regionals. But great to see Easy, and he came in, and I believe it was he talked to you or Nick, or you saw it on social media saying, you know, my focus isn't really going to the games. It's not the all-encompassing part of my life right now. I'm going to go out there, kind of let it hang out, have fun. We'll see what happens.
It really looks like Easy's been working on some weaknesses. It was fun to watch him compete this weekend. I didn't expect him to finish so well on that first event with all that body weight, especially with a vest. And he just slowly chipped away, got better and better every event. And I think he'll be well prepared for the games. Stellar performance here this weekend.
There is the guy that you called early on, Logan Collins. You had him pegged for the first time we went on the air Friday morning.
You know, I think it's easy to get caught up in looking at your one rep max and two rep max, and Logan Collins is strong, but sometimes being strong is about how do you apply it inside of a couplet, inside of a chip, or inside of a triplet. And this weekend, there was no one here who could do that better than Logan Collins. Just the model of consistency and just a pleasure to watch as far as movement and output.
Joseph Gesser talking with Travis Williams. And Travis Williams should be headed back. It's 6th, a 9th, a 5th, a 4th in the finish here. Today he came in with 404 points. He should be safe. Don't want to count your chickens for the hatch, but I think he's good to go back to Madison, Wisconsin. We'll find out here soon enough as the judges still tabulate the final numbers with the scoring staff here. Well, I can't imagine what it was like when it was everyone take your stopwatch up there and figure everything up. Chip timers have made a huge, huge difference.
Hopefully all the judges had good handwriting. You'd have to go back and ask them five times. What was that, a 4? Is that a 6?
Everyone anxiously waiting.
I think in an age when you talk so much about individual athletes turning team, it's really cool to see someone like Dakota Rigger. I hope we're pronouncing your last name correctly, but it's really cool to see him go from team to individual and have such a nice performance this weekend.
There's a big fan club, and you love where he trains in Lafayette, Colorado. Got a lot of box golf, Cutthroat CrossFit. He's been to the games again. He went on 808's team, and they finished as high as 4th when he was competing with them back in 2015, but he's going on his own. Being a part of a team, very, very special. Also very special. You've done it both ways to make that accomplishment.
It is a really good feeling. I think it validates you as an athlete, and it's a cool way to put your own programming to the test.
All right, let's get set to head down to the fourth. Hey, we'll go in just a minute, but let's head on down to the fourth, Kiki Dixon.
The shootout is over, and this is who remains standing. In first, it's Logan Collins. In second, Travis Williams. In third, Dakota Rager. In fourth, Elijah Muhammad.
Well, there they are, your top five, led by Logan Collins, Travis Williams, Dakota Rager, Easy Bahamut, Tommy Venus, and it is official now. James Venus did exactly what he needed to do to secure that fifth position.
And like I said earlier, it's nice to see a couple surprises in there. It's always neat to see new blood at the games. How will they be able to handle the surprises Dave throws at them for the first time? It's never easy as a new Times Games athlete.
And again, Collins again, as we take a look at the final results. Overall, final results, and there are your top five headed to Madison, Wisconsin. Let's head down to Nick Zielinski.
Logan Collins still catching his breath in the excitement. Sir, you are the South Regional Champion. How does that roll off the tongue?
Well, it sounds pretty nice right now, but I'm very relieved that the weekend's over with and ready to get to work on some more important stuff right now. So
you told me yesterday that you went to the games last year and you didn't have a lot of fun. You're used to being the fittest guy around. What can we expect from you getting ready for the CrossFit Games, and what can we expect to see from you in Madison?
Just a different mental approach, for sure, 100%. I think the physical stuff was there last year, but just being able to throw the mental side of it, knowing that it's probably not the smartest thing to do is go out and try to PR your deadlift on event two, knowing that, how that's going to play out the rest of the week. So, you know, experience, like everybody always talks about it, but experience does play a huge role in that training. So, but yeah, just working harder, working more more efficiently with my mind, and just yeah, putting in more work is what it boils down to. So,
the pride of Wiley, Texas CrossFit, rejoice. Logan Collins, go enjoy yourself, my man. We'll see you in Madison.
Thanks, Nick. I appreciate it. Thanks, man.
Come on in. We still alive? We still going? We good? Tommy Venus, probably one of the best. The guys up in the booth compared it to Josh Bridges' celebrations. After you finished event six, one of the best ever. What kind of relief was that for you to get that finish and get that qualification spot?
I'm not really good at those workouts. It's always been a struggle of mine just to go hard and forget about the pain and just go. So to finish right there with everyone in front, I was pretty ecstatic about.
You're 20 years old. You busted on the scene 2 years ago. I remember talking to you in Dallas. You finished highly in a couple of events. What's this journey like been for you over these last 2 years?
Unreal, just fun. Getting out with my bros. My best bro is my coach. Hats off to him. He created me. So just having fun, having a good time. So I'm excited to be there.
There's some talk about and chatter about your outfit. You had the half shirt going on, the lime green shorts. Was that is that purposeful for the last event?
Yeah, my coach went to Adams State, green and black colors. And then he always wears this Superman cutoff that was his, like, Friday Night Lights shirt. So just representing.
All right, you're going to Madison, Wisconsin. You're a games qualifier, fifth out of the South region. How does that feel to have that attached to your name now?
Unreal. I'm beyond excited. I can't even put it into words. That's it?
That's it. That's all he's got. Tommy Venus, congratulations, man. Enjoy yourself.
Thank you, so.
Welcome back up here to the booth. Sri Chan rejoined us here along with James Hobart. What a weekend, guys. And now we have five men, five women, five teams headed up to Madison, Wisconsin.
An exciting first weekend of the regional. So many surprises. I heard a little bit of people saying, oh, there's only six events. These six events did not disappoint, and it wouldn't have mattered if we'd had a seventh.
Well, it was fun. Again, a lot of surprises here, and it has been a blast this weekend. As you mentioned, two more weeks to go. We still have five more regionals. A lot of spots out there for grabs.
From the team side, I think they should be paying attention to what happened here. A lot of good lessons learned there. Also very exciting to see big friends headed up to Madison. First time we've seen a team from Latin America go to the games since they instituted the Super Regional. So that's very fun to watch. Awesome point of the weekend.
A couple of other things to learn. We just saw on that box jump over, hey, pick it up, drag it, instead of pulling it down from the floor. And what I'd really like to say a congratulations to is Bethany Branham, rookie, first-time regional, making it to the games. Congratulations. That is no easy feat.
And that's it for our coverage here from the Alamo Dome. For all the official results, go to games.crossfit.com. It's been a blast for everyone behind the scenes. James Hobart, Sheree Chan, I'm Jeff Brightwell. Thanks for joining us from the Lone Star State.
Week number one of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games Regionals is officially in the books. We have 10 men, 10 women, and 10 teams heading to the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games in Madison, Wisconsin. Welcome inside the CrossFit Update Studios, everybody. I'm Sean Woodland with Tommy Marquez and Pat Sherwood. Kayla Banfield and Brooke Entz will be along in a moment to check in on social media. But weekend number one certainly did not disappoint. Looking forward to the next two.
No, and congratulations to all the athletes that qualified out there. I'm looking forward to personally meeting you out there in Madison, Wisconsin. You guys earned it, and I'm sure all the rest of the athletes in weeks two and three, thank you all for being the guinea pigs. They will learn from your mistakes and your successes.
And it's only week one, and We've already seen what we would consider a couple of upsets on the individual side and some teams kind of throwing their hat in the ring as early contenders in Madison. So it's been a fun week one.
Let's get to the East and recap everything that happened there, starting with the men. And really no surprise about the top two on top of the overall leaderboard. That's Matt Fraser, who wins again. Patrick Vellner finishes in second place. And then three men who will be making their first trip to the CrossFit Games. Tim Paulson, Cody Mooney, and Michael Palomba are all going to the Games, and Palomba barely edges out Austin Spencer to hang on to that fifth and final spot.
You weren't really expecting much when you came in.
So, I mean, everybody I came with, they kind of, you know, top five, top five, top five. And as much as I kind of encouraged it, I didn't really know what to expect. Last year I came here, finished 18th. My first year here, the first year really doing CrossFit. And then after the Open this year, I did well. Came in here with really no expectations, and I finished pretty well. This is only my second year. I'm only 21. So, I mean, I got a very bright future.
Have you been a fan of the sport for a while?
I started paying attention to it pretty much when I started, probably that August after the 2015 Games. I know who this guy is. I know Frony and all these. Like, you idolize them, you make them out to be, you know, not real people. And now I'm going to go compete with him on the big stage. So, I mean, it's a dream come true.
21 years old, going to the Games, a relative newcomer to the sport. I mean, an impressive weekend for him.
Who knows what's going to happen with him, right? But this could be somebody we chatted about for a while. To be so good so fast, this was only his second year basically doing CrossFit. Oh, and by the way, he made it to regionals his first year doing CrossFit last year, where he took 18th, and now he occupies a qualifying spot heading out to his very first Games. Out of all the events, he only had one outside the top 10, event number one. Then he reined it in and had a great 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, so not coincidence. We'll see him out there in Madison.
And what is it with these newcomers in the East? We saw two guys right ahead of him in Tim Paulson and Cody Mooney kind of jumping into the top five there as well. For Tim Paulson, man, patience pays off. The old fifth time's the charm, if you will, at regionals. Never lower than sixth. He hung tough with Fraser and Vellner all weekend, got himself an event win to kind of showcase and put a stamp on his performance to look back on. And on the other side of that, just behind him in Cody Mooney, here's a guy who was 14th a few years ago at regionals, 10th and in 2015, doesn't make it to regionals as an individual last year, goes team, comes right back, makes it to the CrossFit Games. He's only 23 years old as well, so a couple of youngsters alongside Fraser and Vellner that are kind of making their names for themselves in what was a pretty erratic regional.
Yeah, let's go to the women's side now, and a woman that we knew would be contending for a spot winds up on top of the overall leaderboard, not where we expected her. In fact, Carol Ann Reason-Thibault led wire to wire, wins the East Regional ahead of the two-time defending fittest woman on earth, Catherine David's daughter. Carrie Pierce is third. Dani Horan, going back to the Games, was very emotional when she heard her name announced. And then Chelsea Hughes hangs on in event number six to make her first trip to the CrossFit Games. But Dani Horan, great to see her back at the CrossFit Games in 2017.
All the girls are so fit and so strong, and it's awesome. It makes me be a better athlete. It makes me want to be better, so it's great to have such a competitive region and awesome girls.
Cool. So after dancing and trying to get back to the Games for a little while, like, what does it mean to you?
It means a lot. A lot has happened, obviously, in the last 2 years, and I've had to do a lot of self-reevaluation, and I've changed my training entirely, so it means a lot, and all my hard work has paid off.
Heading into the final event, Dani Horan and Chelsea Hughes had breathing room, but they were by no means safe. They step up, they get themselves to the CrossFit Games.
Just a veteran. I mean, this is going to be Dani's fourth trip to the Games. She knows how to just keep in the fight the entire time. You heard her say to Rory that she changed up her training. What she did, I spoke with her on the phone, she cut her volume in half this year. And she was worried, you know, hey, I'm doing less, will I be less? Well, that's not the case. We're going to see her heading back out to Madison. And then another woman who's been trying for a while, Chelsea Hughes. She's been to the Games before on a team with Brick Nation, tried a couple times to go through regionals as an individual, didn't qualify, but it worked out this time. Two fighters, I can't wait to see them throw down.
Two awesome stories. But for me, The show that got put on by Caroline Reese and Tebow just steals the cake. Look at just how she performed the first 2 days in particular. Three event wins. The first five events all second place or better. What a difference a year makes, right? Last year, the final event was really the event that dashed her hopes of maybe catching up to Katrin David's daughter. This year, the final event is basically a victory lap. She cruises to a sixth place finish, puts a stamp on a victory that I don't think a lot of people saw coming in. Kind of, you know, turn some heads, and people are going to be talking about this.
Caroline Reese and Tebow is definitely, you know, the number one surprise of the East Regional. Over to the teams. Team Back Bay wins the final three events, and they won three of the last four events. They take the regional by 20 points over Team CrossFit Milford. Reebok CrossFit won with Austin Maliolo and Spencer Hendel finished in third place. And then CrossFit Queens and Ocean States CrossFit have a good day number three, and they are going to the CrossFit Games. But it's Team Back Bay getting the win. They are heading to Wisconsin.
Does that sound
amazing? Absolutely amazing.
Great performance. Four first place finishes. So in this six events, three other top threes. What holes are left in your armor?
Just continue to keep working our individual weaknesses, and then just keep working as a team. And just keep improving.
Speaking of keep working, keep improving, what is the plan going forward toward the games?
Well, first off, our coach, Josh, who's awesome, he's like helped us with
Love
everything.
You, Herb.
Yeah. So he helped us with everything, and we're definitely going to swim a lot, more worm work, more running, biking, all the stuff we need to get ready for Madison.
We'll see you at the games. Team Back Bay, the 2017 team champions.
I don't care what regional you're in. You win four of the six events. Right. You're definitely a contender when you get to the games.
Team Back Bay representing Reebok CrossFit Back Bay absolutely smashed this thing. 580 points. Wound up with a 20-place cushion over second place. They have a former Games individual member with Jessa Lemoyne on there. They themselves are a multi-year Games team, and you get a sense of why they're such a veteran team, right? I mean, they smashed the regional, and then they still have a laundry list of things that they feel they need to improve upon. And just behind them in second place, not far behind actually, is CrossFit Milford. Remember, this is a team that took four second place finishes this weekend. That's nothing to shake a stick at. Every finish inside the top five. Remember, they finished second at the games just a couple of years ago, did some reloading with their athletes, and I think this is a team worth watching in August, Nick. Every once in a while, we see a team or an athlete that doesn't necessarily win their regional go on to almost outperform what they did at regionals at the games. This could be one of those teams.
Social media has been a buzz all weekend long as the community has been talking about what's been going on during the regional competitions. Caleb Banfield and Brooke Entz have been all over this for us, but now I'm guessing that since we know some of the qualifiers, the conversation has probably turned to that.
It's all about that. I mean, I almost can't keep up with the posts and the pictures just about who's qualifying and who's going to the CrossFit Games this year, and also all the rookies that we're seeing. On the team side, which is super exciting, we kind of chose to just show you a few pictures of different teams that are going from both regions, the East and the South.
First up, we've got CrossFit Queens from East, then CrossFit Milford are making an appearance on our board as well. Salt Lake City, congratulations for them, first time going. Wasatch Brutes as well, who absolutely annihilated the weekend.
Here we are. Another, Wasatch Brutes right
there. There we go. Another photo of CrossFit Queens. As you can see, there are really...
The queens of the queens. They were definitely holding the team together.
And finally, an amazing and very emotional video from Big.
This is a team coming from Latin America that... They have been trying to come back since they combined regions. Latin America is a super strong community, and they finally are sending some people since 2014. And I mean, honestly, that's what I'm looking forward to the most, and what really made me the most excited. The Latin America community is super strong and very fierce.
I've loved watching the community. Obviously, all the teams have a lot of emotions, but the community, especially Latin America, gave me, as Annie Sakamoto would say, chicken skin. Back to you guys at the desk.
Kayla and Brooke, more from them in a quick second. We'll be talking more about Big Friends here as well. As we turn our attention to the South, we will start with the men. We just watched them wrap up. And for the second straight year, the man who wins the South Regional did not win a single event. Logan Collins, 527 total points. His best finish was a second place in events four and events five. Travis Williams, he didn't win an event either. He finishes second. Dakota Rager will finish in third, followed by Elijah Muhammad. And then Tommy Venus making his first trip to the CrossFit Games with Logan Collins, just consistent throughout. We always say this, consistency pays off. Doesn't win an event, but wins the regional.
And just one of the many surprises out of the South Regional. He was exciting from the get-go, but I was very curious as to whether or not he was going to hold on. Did he just have a good day one? Oh, then he had a good event three. Event four seemed to go pretty well for him. I mean, so consistent. His only finish, like you said, outside of the top three was the very final event where he took 10th. Last year as a rookie at the game, he took 31st. Said he didn't enjoy it. I get that, but I think he's going to be one of those guys that we say being a veteran makes such a big deal. He understands that space, and he's going back. I can't wait to see what he can do.
On the other side of that spectrum with a veteran, we have a newcomer in Tommy Venus who took that fifth and final spot. He was actually my dark horse pick coming to this one as well. So these guys are making me look like I know what I'm doing sometimes, I guess. But I was so impressed with how he did the first 2 days. Every finish, seventh place or better. Kind of put a little pressure on himself with a 16th place finish to start the day. But you know what? The youngster at just 20 years old shows up big in that final event, closes the door on any possibility of Sean Sweeney overtaking him for fifth. And he's a guy we have to watch. He's been to the regionals three times at 20 years old.
Wow.
I mean, talk about a bright future.
Yeah, and if all of a sudden, athlete, whoever, you're out there and Tommy Marquez says you're a dark horse, take that as a compliment because
right.
Apparently you know what you're talking about. You're going to wind up going to the game. Let's go to the women's side of things where Tennille Reed breaks Camila Blanc-Bazinet's stranglehold on that regional. Tennille takes it by 10 points. Margot Alvarez wins the final event. She winds up in third place. And then Bethany Branham and Alexis Johnson, as Bethany Branham, the only rookie out of that group heading to the CrossFit Games. But man, Tennille Reed was not in the conversation as far as a woman who might win this regional heading in.
No, I mean, she'd been trying to go to the Games for a few years. In 2014 and 15, she barely missed it. Made it last year, had a tremendous rookie season where she took 11th, almost broke into the top 10. But since that was her first appearance, she wasn't really on our radar. But holy smokes, just came in and just nothing but threes and twos and a first place over the course of the weekend. Like we said, in a regional where if Camille is competing, you watch her because she's going to win. Tennille not having any of it. I can't wait to see what she can do on the big stage now with more experience under her belt, more confidence.
I was so impressed by Bethany Branham, the rookie. Her first year at regionals, and she's going to the CrossFit Games. I mean, she had a couple of slip-ups in events 2 and 5, but you know what? Showed some composure beyond her years of experience. Didn't let it rattle her. Kept everything else inside the top 10, which was enough to get her to the Games. We had a chance to interview her before, and I was just amazed at how composed and kind of carefree she was about how well she had performed up to that point. You know what, Sean? She's a Bulldog owner as well, so that's saying
something.
Well,
there you go. You just moved up in my list, so congratulations, Bethany. Bring your dog to Madison. I would love to meet him or her. We've already seen the social media buzz about the team qualifiers. Let's go back over to Brooke and Kayla for what people are saying about the individual qualifiers.
Just as excitement, maybe a little bit more excitement, probably because the individuals just finished and all the team stuff came through a little bit earlier. Lots of exciting stuff, a lot of rookies going, and I know for myself, I'm really excited when a new rookie comes through, but I'm also so happy for like Danny Horan, people that haven't made it back in a really long time or had something that kept them from getting back, you know, trial after trial, and hopefully, maybe that's because I'm hoping that I can follow in her footsteps next year. But yeah, we've got some photos from some individuals that are going back, like Easy Muhammad.
Starting off with a very funny gif from 2015 where Izzy Muhammad is just having a little relax there.
I remember Matt talking about him when he was out there. Everyone was cheering him on to keep going.
Bethany Branham has a photo of her crossing the line after day two, sorry. And we have a photo of Alexis Johnson. A very nice black and white photo of her lifting a dumbbell. Travis Williams, I love his quote there, the face that you make when you see Logan Collins. And a very nice photo of Pat Vellner and Tim Paulson fist bumping each other. Good to see them getting amongst it together.
A lot of great performances this weekend. We had a blast with all of you guys. We know we were asking a lot of you to help us stay entertained, to stay as active with us as possible, and we want to thank you for all of the work, all the photos, all the questions. Keep them coming for the weeks to come. Have the best time watching all the events, watching the excitement, and stay in touch. Thank you. Back to you, Sean.
Thank you, Brooke. Thank you, Kayla. Appreciate all your hard work this weekend and keeping an eye on all the social media stuff. Had a lot of fun with that. Let's take a look now finally at the South team qualifiers. And this probably had one of the best feel-good stories of the weekend. That's because finally someone from Latin America is going to the games under our current format. That's Big Friends. They finished in third with 501 points. The Wasatch Brutes has that kind of DNA of the old Hacks Pack team. They win. Salt Lake City CrossFit finishes second, and then Omnia and then Pillar CrossFit are your five teams heading to the CrossFit Games. But, man, the Wasatch Brutes were pretty much dominant this weekend. And Big Friends is the team that everyone's talking about.
Big Friends, the second qualifier out of the South region. You guys are the first team from Latin America since the South became three regions to go to the CrossFit Games. You're headed to Madison, Wisconsin. What was that feeling like when they called your name?
It's awesome. It's really, it's a dream. It's like a dream. We couldn't be more happier. This is for us, for our family, our coach, that is, who put a lot of things for our team, big. And it's awesome. It is a dream. And this team is, I don't know, it's something special. Big.
They're going to be fun to watch in Madison. And this is a team that almost wasn't, because quite a few of their team members got individual invites that they turned down for a chance to compete as a team, and it pays off.
And all those capable, competent individuals came together into one beautifully cohesive team. They absolutely crushed it, the number one seed out of the Latin American region, and they were fourth worldwide. You saw that leaderboard that we put up with just all the American flags and then bang, the Argentinian flag. What you don't understand, I've been all over Latin America, they're not just going to have Argentina cheering for them. They're going to have the entire span of Latin America rallying around them, and you're going to feel that in Madison.
Yeah, you got the feel-good story there, but I think you have a games contender in Wasatch Roots based on what they did this weekend. If you look at their first 2 days, three firsts and a second, and honestly, they may have told you that they're still gunning for that top spot, but it's a little bit hard to give that same level of effort when you know you pretty much have first place locked up. But even then, maybe going on a little bit of cruise control, they get a third place and a fifth place to close out the weekend. I personally believe they've emerged as one of the early contenders that's going to give Mayhem some trouble.
Week one is finished. Week two is going to be here before you know it. And here's what's on tap in week two of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games Regionals. Central, Pacific, and California all going next week. If you're here in the States, the good thing about the Pacific Regional is it will start Thursday night. So you can watch basically CrossFit from Thursday night all the way through Sunday. I mean, it's going to be nonstop coverage. Kayla Banfield, unfortunately, is leaving us, but she will be at the Pacific Regional, so you get to see her there. That is always a blast. The Central Regional is in Nashville, Tennessee, first time we've been there, and the California Regional back in Del Mar. Who are you guys looking forward to watching in those three competitions?
Can I choose multiple athletes?
Sure.
I want to see Brandon Swan after not making it. He's fired up. I'd love to see him make it back. I'm always a fan of watching Josh Bridges throw down. He's going to do something exciting regardless of how the event goes. And then legend, Becca Voigt. I mean, come on.
Yeah. I'm excited to see if Ricky Garrard can come over, overcome a little bit of heartbreak last year just missing the games. And then I really want to see Dan Bailey, another guy who missed the games last year, see if he can bounce back, make it to another CrossFit Games, and hopefully maybe finally get over the hump and get on the podium.
And Bailey back in the Central should be a good battle between him and Scott Panchik. That is it for us for today and for the weekend. I want to thank you for being here. Appreciate you guys tuning in. Appreciate all the stuff that you posted on social media for Brooke and for Kayla. We will be back tomorrow with a full recap show as well, and back next week to kick off week number two of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games Regionals. For Tommy Marquez, Pat Sherwood, Kayla Banfield, Brooke Entz, Sam Farber, and Annie Sakamoto, I am Sean Woodland. Thank all of you again for watching, and we will see you next week.